Welcome, everyone. Like I said earlier, my name is Dan, and I'm really excited to be with you guys here today. I'm really excited about this new series that we're doing called Dangerous Prayers. I know some of you, like Tyler and Brooke said, you've kind of been following on social media, and you've seen maybe the graphic for it, or you saw just a little video kind of playing, and you were excited for this series just because you want that lady to pray for you, right? Like anybody, like I look at that and I'm like, I want her praying for me. Like I don't know who she is, but I want her to pray. Anyone who like has fire when they pray, that means God really listens, I guess. Like I saw that and I got excited for this series. But in reality, we're talking about prayer for the next 4 weeks. And really, here's the funny thing about prayer. When it comes to prayer, really everybody prays. Everybody prays. Even people, I've met people who don't even believe in God who'll admit in an honest moment, yes, I've prayed before. It's one of those like, I don't believe in God, I don't believe. But if he's there, like I'm just gonna just in case. You know one of the moments that we all pray? Like every single one, regardless of who you are, I don't know a lot of you guys, but I know you all get really spiritual when you see this. Like all of us pray when we see that, don't we? Like, we look at that. Some of you just felt anxious right when you saw that. Like, your palms kind of got sweaty. Yes, you have some repenting to do, right? Like, you saw this, and it's just like, we've all, like, God, if you're real. You know, like, God, I promise I will never speed again, right? Like, we've all prayed those prayers before, haven't we? Like, sometimes there's just silly prayers, or, come on, let's be honest, have you ever prayed when you do this? Like, God, I promise you, Lord, if you're real, I'll tithe on this, God. The church would really, God, you're blessing yourself here. Lord, this is win-win. This is win-win, God. So please, Lord, if you're real, like we pray, or come on, and this, we need a moment of healing here, because I know I'm deep in the heart of Texas here. A lot of you prayed some really, really serious prayers this year, January 15th, when this moment was happening, right? Like you guys were on your knees, like promising to go to convents for the rest of your life if they just block this kick, right? Like we all pray. And what's so silly is sometimes we pray about some of the dumbest things, right? Like there's people on both sides of this team kneeling down, praying that the kick would go, that the kick would get blocked. And like, it's just deciding which team God liked more, right? Like everybody's praying, and clearly he liked the Packers. Until the following week, when it wasn't prayers that I was praying, but curses I was saying as we got destroyed by the Falcons, right? Like we all pray all kinds of prayers. And then there's actually another category of prayers beyond kind of silly, trivial prayers. I believe it was the great theologian that put it this way. He said this, some of God's greatest gifts are unanswered prayers, right? Like the great theologian Garth Brooks, like how many of you, be honest, in junior high, in high school, prayed for that love of your life in junior high, right? And you just prayed, God, if you're out there, would you make this happen, right? And now some of you look back and you're still bitter that God didn't do it. But some of the rest of us maybe that found someone else and realized, man, that was, I thank God that he didn't answer that prayer. We've all probably from time to time have prayed prayers that we're just so grateful God said, you poor dummy. Like, you know what? I'm actually not going to answer this one and you can thank me later. We've all prayed these kinds of prayers, but there's actually another category of prayers. You know, there's the silly and trivial prayers. There's these kinds of prayers, the prayers that we're grateful God doesn't answer. And then, this is what we're gonna talk about today, there's actually dangerous prayers. Prayers that are literally dangerous prayers to pray. You see, let me unpack this a little bit. You might be thinking like, what do you mean like dangerous prayers? Have you ever gone through a season you just realize how impatient you are? And maybe you snap at your kids or you're sitting in your car and you've got nowhere to really go. You're not really in a hurry, but you're stuck in traffic and you just feel so like, oh, come on, you dummy. Or someone's going real slow around the curve and you're like, don't flip it, you know? And you're like, take it easy, you know? And you just feel impatient and you pray. What do you pray? You go, God, help me be more patient. Now, here's the thing. Like, God doesn't have this, like, patience wand, right? That he, like, zaps you and he's like, okay, I'll give you a little more patience. And then all of a sudden, you're more patient. Do you know what? Do you know what the prayer, God, help me be more patient? You know what this prayer really means? When you're praying this, what this equals, this prayer, this is just like praying, God, please, please, Could you put me in more difficult situations? You know, like I haven't been through enough like trying situations. When you're praying, I want to be more patient. What you're really asking for is times to choose patience, right? Because God's not going to zap you and go, okay, now you're more patient. He'll go, oh, you want patience. Okay, then we're going to put a lot of cars in front of you. And they're all going to go really slow. And it's going to be on 150 heading out to Wimberley where you can't pass anyone, right? And they're going like 35. Like that, I'll help you be more patient. I've been through that. My daughter has lessons out that direction and God helps me a lot with that. And right, it ends up being a dangerous, dangerous prayer. We've heard the old adage, be careful what you wish for, right? Because you might actually get it. Today, what we're talking about is be careful what you pray for because God might just answer it, right? It's one of those prayers. These next four prayers we're going to talk about are prayers that we're wanting to say before you pray this, be careful. Like really think this one through because God might actually say, okay, right? And that could actually be dangerous. It reminds me of a book series that I've read to our kids before. I love it. How many of you guys have read The Chronicles of Narnia by C.S. Lewis? A great series. And I love in the very first one, in The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe, these children are first go into this land called Narnia, and they're about to meet the great lion named Aslan. And Aslan is representative of Jesus. And Susan, one of the children, is asking about this lion, and she asks Mr. Beaver, actually, is who she asked. Clearly, it's not real life. And she asks Mr. Beaver, and she says, well, you know, he's a lion, but I mean, he's safe, right? Like, it's okay. He's a safe lion. And I love the reply by Mr. Beaver. He says, safe? Who said anything about safe? Of course he isn't safe, but he's good. And this is a picture of what following Jesus really is like. See, you might have come to a church and maybe you were told like, oh, when you follow Jesus, everything is better and your life gets better and you pray this prayer and finances come your way and all these good things happen. And if you were told that, you were lied to. Like that's not true. Following Jesus, it's dangerous. It's not safe, but it's good. It's clearly, clearly good. You see, following God, I would argue, is far more dangerous than you realize. But it's much better than you could ever imagine. Oh, it's far more dangerous. It'll cost you more, it'll take you further, but it's better than you could ever, ever imagine. And those are the kinds of prayers that we're gonna be talking about. And the prayer we're gonna start off with is really, honestly, it's a prayer I vividly remember praying when I was 18 years old. When I was 18 and I graduated high school, I went to a Bible college and it was called Master's Commission. And I went there because it was this kind of perfect combination between one part Bible college and course curriculum and studying, but it was also one part internship where it was hands-on. I didn't want to just learn in the classroom. I wanted to learn in the real world. So there was this combination of kind of both parts. And it was in Northern Illinois in Rockford where it's cold and winters are long and they last, I don't know, the year. And I vividly remember at 18 years old going to Master's Commission and praying this dangerous prayer we're gonna talk about. And I had no clue the implications of praying that prayer. And I had no clue how that prayer would shift and change my life forever. See, because it was in this first week of Master's Commission that I read this story that I wanna tell you guys real quickly. And I think it highlights and illustrates what we're talking about today so clearly. It's a story of a young boy named Samuel. And in the same way, he kind of went away from home, when he was much younger, and he went to live in the temple. He went to live in the temple with one of the prophets there, and he was growing up to become a prophet. And one day he would become one of the greatest prophets that Israel would know. And young Samuel, when he went there, he went to stay, and he went to bed one night, and the prophet there that he was living with was a guy by the name of Eli. And Samuel went to bed, Eli went to bed, and here's the exchange. Here's what happened. I want to show you guys what happened. Suddenly, and this is as Samuel is sleeping, suddenly the Lord called out, Samuel. Yes, Samuel replied, what is it? And he got up and he ran to Eli. Here I am. Did you call me? So he hears this voice, Samuel, young Samuel is sleeping, and he hears someone call for him. So he does what anyone would do, and he's being a good little student here, and he gets up and he runs to his teacher. He runs to Eli and he says, yeah, what do you need? And Eli, quite confused, is like, I didn't call you. Like, Go back to bed. Go lay down. You're crazy. I'm trying to sleep here, right? Like when our kids get out of bed and you don't really care why they got up. It's like, yeah, yeah, yeah. Go back to sleep, right? It's like, I'm hungry. And you're like, I don't care. Go to sleep. Yeah, it was kind of one of those kind of interactions. And Eli's not really listening. He says, go to bed, go to bed. And a few moments later, someone calls out for Samuel. It's the Lord calls out to Samuel. Samuel gets back up and he comes in and says to Eli, yeah, what do you need? What do you need? And Eli's like, go to sleep, you know, and he sends him back to bed. This happens three different times, and on the third time, Eli's not real quick on the uptake, and Eli realizes what might be happening, and Eli realizes this may be God speaking to young Samuel. So he gives him some instructions, and he says this. He said to Samuel, go and lie down again, and if someone calls you again, say, speak, Lord, your servant is listening. So Samuel went back to bed. So Eli realizes this is probably God speaking to Samuel, and he tells Samuel to go back to bed. Either that or Samuel or Eli really wanted sleep, right? He's like, just say, I'm listening, right? Like, so Eli sends him away, and Samuel goes back to bed. A few moments later, he hears this, and this is what happens. The Lord came and called as before, Samuel, Samuel. And Samuel replied, speak, your servant is listening. Now this is huge. And this prayer that Samuel prays, speak, for your servant is listening, is huge. And I learned some really important things when I was in Bible school. I learned some really important things, and I learned, and this is one of the things I learned that revolutionized everything, and this may not be a shocker to you guys, I wasn't real bright, but the Bible wasn't originally written in English. Crazy, I know, right? Like it wasn't, those people who first wrote it down weren't writing in English, they were writing in Hebrew. And Hebrew is very different from English, and the words that they use and what the words mean. And translators through the years have done an amazing, amazing job at translating. But there's some nuances that we kind of miss. And I learned about one of these nuances when I was in Bible school. And I realized that though this is what Samuel was praying, that the Hebrew language actually stresses physical action. But Greek and Western culture, which this would be us, stresses mental activity. So when Samuel is praying, like, I'm listening, most of us look at that language, look at that word, and we think like, oh, he was just kind of listening. But Hebrew language actually stresses there's activity to that. See, to the Hebrews, to Samuel, to the people who are writing this down, what you do, action, indicates what you believe. What you do indicates what you believe. And this, I'm telling you, this truth alone, this truth of what you do indicates what you believe. If you apply that when you're reading the scriptures, when you're reading about things, if you think like this, it changes everything. Do you know why here at Icon Church we say that our goal is to help people become more like Jesus? Our goal isn't to help people think like Jesus thought. It's because they would look at this, Jesus would look at this and says, ah, that's great. But what are you doing? How are you living? How are you responding? What you say you believe, like that doesn't matter. Like, I'm really not that concerned with you coming and saying, this is what I believe. That's great. We can say all day long, and this is why it was important to the Hebrews, because you could say all day long, oh, I have faith, but not act on that faith. And they would argue, then you don't have faith. See, they stress that. And the word used here, the word used in this explanation when young Samuel said he was listening, that word to listen actually is this Hebrew word shma. Everybody say shma. Oh, you guys are good little Hebrews, right? Like shma. Like, and this was actually the name of one of the prayers that they would pray every single morning. And it starts off with, hear, O Lord, the Israel, or is here we hear, O Lord, our God is one. And it's this prayer of we're listening. But what's important about the shema, what's important about this word is it doesn't indicate like I'm just listening. It's I'm listening because I'm actually gonna do something about it. You see, this word shema stresses action. So whereas we would look at what Samuel prayed and he says, yeah, go ahead and talk, I'm listening. What we would say in the West is I'll decide what to do with it in a moment, right? Like God, go ahead and tell me, I'll listen, and then I'll decide what to do with it. That's not at all what Samuel's prayer was. Samuel saying, I'm listening, and because I'm listening, I'm your servant, I'm gonna do whatever you say. Before you say a word, the answer is yes. You see, Samuel's dangerous prayer wasn't, God, I'll listen to you. Samuel's dangerous prayer was, use me. It was, God, here I am, use me. Use me, Lord, however you want. And it was that prayer, and it was reading that story. Again, I so vividly remember going to Bible school, 18 years old, I remember in the fall of 1999, remember I checked in and figured out classes and figured out who my roommates were and went to my apartment, met my roommates and still so close friends with those three guys. And I remember that first night, I went out onto our balcony and I remember laying down and staring up at the stars. And I had no clue what I'd gotten myself into. I had no clue what this year would entail and what the future would hold. And I remember reading that and having that understanding. And I remember praying, God, here I am, use me. God, use me. And I had no clue that that prayer would bring me to this moment. I had no clue that that prayer would have all the implications through the years. I had no idea. I don't know if I would have prayed that, quite honestly, if I knew what that would mean, because it's a dangerous prayer. And in a moment, we're going to give you an opportunity to pray this prayer. I'm going to give you a chance to say, God, here I am, use me. But before we do that, I want you to understand kind of the implications of that. You see, we take this pretty seriously. I really believe these are actually dangerous prayers to pray. And because of that, I want you to know what you're getting yourself into. So a few truths before we jump into that. First and foremost, that we got to understand this, that first and foremost, God's already calling for you. He's already calling. We're like young Samuel. And sometimes we don't understand that it's God's voice. You just have this pull, this draw, this desire, like, oh, I'd love to do this with my life. And I have no clue what it'd look like. Or man, I just, and some of you, I'm going to be real honest. Some of you, you're not giving yourself a chance to even hear God. You're just not listening. You're taking so little time to pray and say, God, I want to hear you speak. God's already calling. You're just not giving him the opportunity to be heard. Whether you're coming to church so infrequently or you're taking so little time to pray and to do that, God's already calling for you. He's already speaking. Just like young Samuel, he was calling for a while before Samuel understood that it was God. So first and foremost, God's calling for you. I mean, he's calling out to you now. And another important truth that we have to understand that praying a dangerous prayer is only the first step. It's only the first step, but the real magic happens when you have to choose to live out a dangerous prayer. See, a dangerous prayer isn't a prayer we pray with our mouth. It's actually a prayer we pray with our feet. It's something that we're willing to walk out. Dangerous prayers are always followed by demanding actions. Always. It's always followed by demanding actions. God's not going to use you and it not cost you anything. You see, praying for God to use you will always cost you something. It'll cost you something. Being used by God is a costly endeavor. I want to let you know firsthand, I've experienced this. I've lived this out. Man, serving Icon Church, being one of the people that helps make this place run, has been one of the greatest joys of my life. But it's cost me. It's absolutely cost me. And praying this prayer, I want you to know, it will cost you. It'll cost you. It'll cost you your comfort. It'll cost you your time. It'll cost you effort. It'll probably cost you financially. And the people that have stood on stages and told you that following Jesus is easy, it's not true. It's dangerous. But at the same time, it's good. It's so good. I absolutely love what I get to do, but it has absolutely cost me. See, when God uses someone, he uses all of them. Their present, their past, their future. He uses every part. And that's the beauty of being used by God. As you look back in your life at different seasons, at different times, maybe you have regrets and maybe there's things that you wish you hadn't done. And God says, I can use that too. Those things that you look back to, God wants to use that. And it cost you back then, but God wants to redeem that. He wants to use that moving forward. You're present right where you're at. See, sometimes because it's people that have been to Bible schools that stand on these stages that talk to you, you think being used by God means, well, that means I gotta be a missionary, I guess. That means I need to be a pastor. No. God wants to use you right where you're at. See, he has you in a place so that you can reach people that I can't reach. There are people that you interact with every single day that I will never meet. And God wants to use your present right where you're at. But if you'll let him, if you'll give him the chance, he also wants to use your future. And he wants to shape that and direct that and point you in directions that you'll never know. See, it's scary. I so vividly remember times praying and knowing I was being used by God and knowing I was right in the middle of where he wanted me to be. Times that were so difficult, that were costing me more than I imagined, more than I expected. I knew it would cost me something, but times that it cost me even more than I expected. And as hard as it was, and as painful as it was at times, there was something so sweet about being right in the middle of where I knew God wanted me to be. See, there is no better place to be than right in the middle of being used by God. There's no better place. I remember times in Rockford. I remember times on staff at a church in Austin. I remember times being here. I remember times standing in this room that you guys are in right now. It cost me a ton, but just knowing that I was right in the middle of where God wanted me to be. Just knowing, God, when I prayed that prayer all those years ago, God used me. I want that to be true. And this really is what we want to talk about in this first week, is this prayer, use me. See, we could have chosen multiple different directions. We could have chosen, like I said, we've got 3 other weeks coming. I'm really excited. One of the upcoming weeks, man, you guys do not want to miss this series. I know we've got Memorial Day coming up and kind of summer and kids, but this series, you guys do not want to miss this. One of these weeks, we're going to have a missionary coming in who's been in Africa, who feels led by God to take him and his young family to the Middle East, to a nation that they can't even talk about publicly, to take the gospel. He's working with an organization called Live Dead. And he's prayed this prayer, God, use me. I'm telling you, you're not going to want to miss this series. But we had all these options of all these directions to go. And we said on the first week, we want to take this prayer, use me. And we want to do this for a specific reason. See, when we prayed this prayer as a church, see, because this, you don't just pray this prayer once. You pray this multiple times. This has been a prayer that, again, I prayed at 18 and I've prayed at different seasons of my life. And there was an opportunity about 9 months ago that many people in the leadership of this church prayed this prayer, God, use us. We prayed this. And the opportunity that was before us is the room you're all sitting in. You've heard us talk about this a few times, but I want to talk about how this fleshes out, what this looks like, and really why we chose Use Me to be the first week in this series. See, the reason we took this direction is we want you to know that we're still in the middle of this. And in fact, this prayer led us to this very moment. See, about 9 months ago, I mean, actually, the whole process has been longer ago than that. We had this opportunity to move our church from a set-up, tear-down situation to move into a permanent facility. And we looked at the opportunities, and we looked at God's calling, and we looked at a 20,000-square-foot building on 14 acres, on visibility from I-35, and we looked at this, and we said, God, is this what you want? Because, God, here's what we want more than anything. We want to be used by you. And we want this, God, we want you to use us more than we want anything else, because we want to reach more people with this message of helping people actually become more like Jesus, because we believe when this happens, that anything is possible, that the world can be changed forever if enough people just buy into this idea of Jesus and the way that he's living. And we saw this as this huge opportunity. And I sat down with the staff and the leadership and the elder board and the trustees, and we prayed, God, is this how you'd like to use us? And we felt him, just like young Samuel, saying, yes, this is how we want you to be used. So we made this step. And here's what we knew. We knew coming into this place, yes, we knew it cost us a lot, and it did. And I'm so grateful for from the launch team that started this thing, to the elder board and the staff, to that first group of people. It was so great. I stood in front of the church. It'd be like standing in front of you guys, because I know many of you have just started coming to Icon since we've gotten into this building. So I stood up to the church and I said, hey, when we first started, it was the launch team did everything. And now you're the launch team. Like, you're all the staff. You're the like, hey, someone should do that. You're someone, you know, like it is now all of us. And it was this exciting time that we all leaned in saying, God, use us. And we knew this incredible thing would happen. And this, guess what? This incredible thing happened. And almost overnight, the church doubled in size. And there's a lot, and here's what I want to do. I want to pull the curtain back a little bit. Because sometimes in church world, all you see is like this, right? Like the band killing it, and it, you know, just this awesome moment of worshiping with God, and you know, different things happening, and that's what you see. But I want to pull the curtain back to show you what this prayer really looks like behind the scenes. See, what this prayer looked like for Icon Church, when you pull back the curtain a little bit, is use me, what it cost us is a little more than three times what it cost us to be a setup and teardown church. Imagine running a business and you have an opportunity to expand and you look at your numbers and it says, yes, to expand, it's gonna cost you more than triple what you're doing right now. That would be terrifying, right? That is terrifying, right? Like firsthand, I experienced that and we looked at that. We go, man, can we even do this? But we knew the people that we could reach and the life change that could happen and marriages that we had seen restored and lives that we'd seen completely changed. We knew that could happen on a larger scale. And this group of people said, yes, use me. And we did it and we moved into this place and because so many people were willing to be used. We came into here and we doubled overnight. And it was this miraculous thing and we were so excited and so many of you out. There was a family in this church that had just started coming since we moved in this building that we were able to have dinner with last night. And I just afterwards, I thought, I was like, God, thank you so much for people that prayed this prayer. But here's the thing. We find ourselves right now in a similar season in many ways. In a time as I pull back the curtains, I want you to know I'm asking you to pray this prayer. In fact, I chose this week to be our first week on purpose because God needs you. Isn't that a crazy thought? Think about that. The God of the universe needs you. The God of the universe that created it all chose to limit himself to be used by his people. God said, I'm going to limit myself so that I can allow these people to be used to expand my kingdom. And we have this incredible opportunity. And again, as I just pull back the curtain, as a church moves into the summer, it's a trying time because you know what happens in the summer? Many of you go on vacation. I go on vacation. I love you guys, but not that much. Like I need to get out of here, right? So there'll be a time that I'll take some time off with my family and I'll go on vacation. And that happens in the summer and it's good and it's healthy. But you know what that happens? That happens as that happens in the attendance, the giving drops a little bit and the church begins to run a little bit leaner. So we need some of you to pray this prayer. We need some of you that have been sitting back and enjoying these services to say, God, I'll be used. I'll step up. I've been checking this thing out, but I need to get involved. I need to begin to serve. I need to join a small group. I need to start a small group. I need to start giving. I need to support this church because this church started off as a church I come to. Now this church is my family. It's my family. And I'm going to come alongside my family. And I'm going to help my family. I got to see a picture of this a few nights ago there was a person in this church that was going through a difficult time and they just shared real honesty. And I watched the church. I watched you rally around that person. Say, God, use me. I just heard you. So God, I'll let you use me. I'm going to step out and I'm going to help this family. I'm going to help this person. And that's what's so beautiful. So in a moment, I'm going to pray. I'm going to pray a prayer. I'm going to pray this prayer of God, use me one more time. Well, I'm probably going to pray this prayer a lot more times in my life, but I'm going to pray this prayer again. God, use me. And we decided, we thought, and I thought about this morning. And I thought, you know, we could bring the band back up and play the song and have this moment of worship. But can I be honest? Sometimes that gives us all the right feelings and we don't quite think through all the implications of that. So I decided I want this to be like that moment I had sitting on my balcony in the fall of 1999, when no one was around, I was by myself. There was no worship song. There was no awesome band and some ginger singing sweetly in my ear. You know, like I didn't have that then. Benji, I could have used you back then. It would have made the prayer easier. But we don't want to do that. We don't want to take this moment. I want us to really think through, this implication. I'm sorry, Benji. I'm sorry, man. I want us to really think through this moment and really go, God, knowing what it's gonna cost me, knowing it's gonna cost me some of my time, some of my energy, knowing that it's gonna cost me financially, because I'm gonna ask you not just to pray this prayer, but to actually do this. I want us to have a Hebrew mentality when we say, God, use me, that it's not just this prayer that we pray, that it's a life we live of God, use me. And I want some of you to take actual physical steps. I'd like all of you to take physical steps towards this. Because this is a dangerous, dangerous prayer if you choose to pray this. So I don't want you to do this just because the pastor is asking you to. I want you to choose to do this. In a moment, I'm going to pray. I'm going to pray this, and then I'm going to pause. And I'm going to wait. And I don't want you to pray anything out loud. I don't want anyone to be listening. But I want you to think through, God, do I really want this? Because this is really going to cost me. And I know when I pray this, I'm actually going to walk this out, that there's going to be demanding actions of me. Some of you will need to, right when you're done praying this, you'll need to sign up for reoccurring giving. I'm going to tithe. I'm going to give back to God. I'm going to financially support his church. Some of you need to go out to the info center and say, I've been sitting here for a while. I need to get plugged in. I need to serve. Tell me where you need me. I have this gift. I have this ability. I have this talent. I want to be used. Some of you, here'd be a great way to be used. Immediately following this service, every single week, right during second service, we have a thing called Growth Track. And this week is 301. We're talking about together, community, small groups. Some of you have heard about Growth Track and you thought, oh, that'd be a good thing at some point. Some of you, after praying this prayer, you need to go. It's right after, we've still got childcare. It's right up these stairs, or there's stairs out there that you can go up. There's a classroom up there. Someone will be there to meet you. And that's what you need to do. There's physical action required when we pray this prayer. I'm gonna pray and then I'll pause. And I'll let you pray that same prayer. God, here I am. Use me. God, use my past. Use where I'm at right now with what I have this moment. God, I'm willing for you to use my future however you want. Before I even know what you're asking me, God, the answer is yes. Yes. So in light of that, in light of knowing how dangerous of a prayer this is, in light of knowing that this will cost you, that God's not gonna zap you with some wand, that you'll actually have to make choices after this, with no music, with no like special moment, let's pray. Let's talk to God. And I believe there'll be countless people around this room that will begin to be used by God in ways that they could never imagine before this moment. And I believe that just like I'm standing all these years later, looking back 18 years later, at one prayer I prayed then, I can't imagine what God did. I know in 18 years from now, we could look back to this moment. You see, I believe this series could be a pivotal series for people in this room, that they begin to pray some dangerous prayers that forever alter the course of their life. So with that in mind, let's pray. God, I thank you so much for this room. And I thank you so much for the people that prayed this prayer over these past few years to get us here. God, we realize that we stand on the shoulders of so many people that came before us, that prayed this prayer and then walked it out. People that served, that sacrificed, that gave so much so that we could sit here. God, we thank you for those people and for the prayers they prayed. In the same way, I believe that in decades from now, generations from now, they will look back at this room and they will look back at this moment to a group of people that prayed this prayer, and they will be standing on the shoulders of the people in this room. So God, I pray, I will lead the way. God, here I am. Use me. God, whatever you have for me, whatever that means, God, before you ask anything of me, the answer is yes. And now, God, I give this room that same opportunity. I'll pause so that they can have a moment with you. God, I thank you so much for the dangerous prayers that were just uttered in this room. God, people knowing full well what it would cost them. People knowing that there's action required after this, and they still chose to pray. God, I believe that destinies were altered, that future decisions were just made by that one prayer of, God, use me. So God, I thank you so much for the faith of this room. God, not an intellectual assent to anything, but a willingness to do whatever's required, because that's what true faith is. So God, now we thank you, and we realize that the true work comes now as we walk out of this room and we put legs to what we just prayed. And we pray with our feet and with our hands and with our minds, with our finances and with our time. God, I thank you for this room. We pray these things in your name. And everybody said, amen.